We have with us Kunal Purohit, an independent journalist who's done some path-breaking work on the ground on looking at not just how the ordinary person thinks or feels, but on how the connection between the new technology, WhatsApp, and perceptions are built, particularly WhatsApp and elections. So Kunal, thank you so much for having
this
conversation.
Thank you for having me here.
You know, we are all trying to decode the verdict, and for some of us it was more of a surprise, some of us less of a surprise.
Right.
But just cutting to the chase, and this business of WhatsApp and its influence. First question is, would it have been possible to work on a Magnum Modi Messiah image without a contrasting fake news demonizing detrimental Congress image?
I feel like when you talk of WhatsApp and when you talk of building Modi's image, one thing which is very essential in the political discourse that we've seen ever since 2013 happened, you know, when he was announced as the Prime Minister candidate, is this idea of myth making around Modi, right? So we've been hearing stories even before he became the PM that he works for so many hours, that he's so hardworking, there's this and that. Now, there's only to a certain extent that the mainstream media can carry this image, you know. There's only to a certain extent that they can actually pursue and promote this image. And that's where WhatsApp as a technology is extremely useful. So in my experiences, WhatsApp has been used immensely to contribute to the myth-making project. You know, some of the stuff that I have found in my investigations, we'll talk of how Modi has done this without telling anyone, how Modi has done that without telling anyone. You know, how Modi has been named by America as the world's top most, you know, five most influential leaders. So I got a WhatsApp forward with a photo of his, you know, accepting an award of some sort. And that's the kind of myth making that happens, you know.
And that's fake news, I mean.
Much of it is fake news. Much of it is disinformation. Much of it doesn't exist. Some of it is also, you know,
You tweak
a relevant news item a bit. So when he receives an award, you exaggerate what the award was actually meant for. So I've seen that happening as well. And I feel like WhatsApp, by the way, nature of the app, enables this kind of use, you know. So it enables people who are using WhatsApp to create and spread content, to create content which is unchecked. So there's no one actually going to recheck and tell you, oh, that's actually not what happened, you know. That's not why he got the award, for instance. Or that's fake. Modi was not named one of the five most influential people in the world. And WhatsApp enables that. So it's a chamber where you keep pouring your content in without ever getting a rebuttal of sorts. And when you contrast that with the mainstream media, which is also promoting, you know, Modi's image, which is also talking about similar strands, even if it's not saying the same thing, you kind of, you know, if you're a layman, if you're a lay average individual in a smaller town, in a village, even in the city, you would possibly put two and two together and say, yeah, that makes sense now. You know, I mean, the WhatsApp forward I got makes sense. So that contribution to myth making, I feel, is immense. And we wouldn't have reached where we are in terms of Modi's cult, his clout, his persona, without WhatsApp being enabled in the way that has been.
To just step back a bit to 2013, before we come to 2019 post-Pulwama.
Right.
I don't know if you were active as a journalist then. I'm sorry, because you're so young, I'm asking.
Right.
2013, when the Muzaffarnagar violence broke out, we in Godhra and Gujarat, we said it was the first kind of carnage where you had email, internet and television. Muzaffarnagar is the first time you had social media.
Right.
Okay, and we saw many of us who were looking at Muzaffarnagar, intervening in the courts, filmmakers like Nakul Soni, and all.
Right.
We saw the way WhatsApps had actually been used to misinform, to create myth-making, hatred against communities, blah, blah, and actually spiral the violence.
Right.
So, coming back to my question, March 2019, Pulwama, Balakot,
right.
Muslim, Pakistan, demons,
right.
And then Congress being portrayed as a Pakistan sympathizer, as a Muslim sympathizer,
right.
And constantly collapsing Pakistan with Muslim, etc. How much is that part of the WhatsApp story?
And to just add to that whole mix that you said, a very crucial part of it that I found was Kashmiri, you know. So Kashmiri was this Muslim, you know, was this Pakistani supporter, was this anti-national, anti-Indian person, and had to be targeted, right? What I did notice was I was through some sources that I have in different parties, I track a few WhatsApp groups every once in a while. So I get access to the WhatsApp groups that there are, and I keep tracking the kind of content that they also provide and that they also circulate. And I was tracking the content before and after Pulwama. And what happened, I saw that was that after the Pulwama terror attack that happened, there was a flood of information which sought to stoke the anger about the attack, but not towards the government or not towards accountability. But it was more towards the people.
So they were not asking why the CRPF Jawans were exposed.
They were not asking any questions about the fact that there could have been a possible intelligence failure, you know, that there was someone in the authority responsible for their safety, and why was that person not being accountable. The questions, and this is what I noticed very, very cleverly, were targeted towards people who were possibly seen to be aiding and helping Pakistan, or who were sympathizers of, you know, India-Pakistan talks or peace. So suddenly you had a rush and a flood of information about these people targeting them, you know. So there would be names saying, oh, this guy had gone to Pakistan 2 years ago. Where are these people now? You know, for instance, and oh, you know, all of these Kashmiris, you know, they're all supporting Pakistan all the time. Let's now target them. So there was a definite call to violence on a lot of these WhatsApp groups that I could have access to. And then, I mean, very soon, unfortunately, we saw that. We saw that then Kashmiris across the country were picked up, were targeted, and were also, you know, there were attempts to send them back to Kashmir. There were attempts to evict them from their houses and evacuate them. So you see that, and that was scary, because you see a call for action on WhatsApp and other social media platforms being actually translated into action on the ground, you know, and that transition is what is scary. Because then you know that hate is definitely, you know, being stoked, and it's being acted upon as well, very actively. And clearly then we saw, you know, the euphoria around Balakot ensured that there were never questions asked about the government. There were never questions of accountability.
मगर पुलवामा बालाकोट को एक तरह का एक नजरिया दिखाना कि मतलब ये सरकार की फेलियर नहीं थी मगर पाकिस्तान की तरफ पूरा नजरिया करना फिर हिंदुस्तानी मुसलमान को टारगेट बनाना साथ साथ कश्मीरी भाई बहनों को बनाना मगर क्या पुलवामा बालाकोट की व्हाट्सएप की कहानी कांग्रेस को गिराने के साथ साथ सक्सेसफुल होती क्या नहीं बिकॉज एवरी टाइम द व्हाट्सएप इन्वेस्टिगेशन आपकी जो मैंने देखी है वहाँ के बार बार कांग्रेस पार्टी को टारगेट करना बहुत ज़रूरी उनको लगा क्योंकि इट वॉज़ अ मेन नेशनल ऑपोजिशन कि कांग्रेस इज प्रो पाकिस्तानी कांग्रेस इज दिस थिंग एंड आई थिंक व्हाट इट अचीव मतलब उससे क्या हुआ कि कांग्रेस जो सवाल पूछ रही थी पुलवामा को लेकर वो चुप हो गई तो उसी में वो सक्सेसफुल हो गया कि बिकॉज ऑफ दिस प्रोपेगेंडा द नेशनल ऑपोजिशन स्टॉप्ड आस्किंग क्वेश्चंस अबाउट द इंटेलिजेंस फेलियर और द सिक्योरिटी ऑफ द सीआरपीएफ जवान्स
बिल्कुल एक जो व्हाट्सएप की इंफॉर्मेशन और डिसइंफॉर्मेशन में जो प्रयत्न था वो ये था कि आप उन लोगों को टारगेट करें जो इस समय देश के साथ नहीं खड़े हो रहे हैं और वो उनका मतलब ऐसा था कि जो सवाल पूछे या फिर जो आर्मी को क्रिटिसाइज़ करे या फिर जो सरकार से सवाल पूछे उन लोगों को आप टारगेट कीजिए तो उसमें हुआ ऐसे कि जैसे एक्टिविस्ट हों जैसे कांग्रेस के या फिर कोई अन्य अपोजिशन पार्टीज़ के हो और ये रूटीनली चलते आ रहा है जब इंडिया में जब भारत में टेरर अटैक्स हुए हैं तब तक एक्टिविस्ट हो या फॉर्मर पुलिस ऑफिशियल्स हो फॉर्मर आर्मी ऑफिशियल्स हो अपोजिशन पार्टीज़ हो उन सारों ने सवाल उठाए हैं कि ये क्यों हुआ ये नहीं होना चाहिए था मुझे याद है जब 26/11 की का अटैक हुआ था मुंबई में तब काफ़ी लोग थे जब सड़कों पे उतरे थे सारों ने नारे लगाए थे सारों ने कहा था ये गवर्नमेंट गिरनी चाहिए इस चीफ मिनिस्टर जाने चाहिए तब चीफ मिनिस्टर को हटाया गया था यहाँ से लेकिन अब आप देखिए कॉन्ट्रास्ट अब हमको आज तक नहीं पता कि वो इंटेलिजेंस फेलियर था अगर था तो किसने किया था वो इंटेलिजेंस
और अजीत दोवाल भी टिके हुए हैं
सारे टिके हुए हैं सारे टिके हुए हैं अब तक कोई मतलब ऐसा कोई स्केपगोट या फिर अब तक कोई टारगेट नहीं मिला कि भाई इस इन 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 कुछ लोगों की वजह से इन्होंने SOP फॉलो नहीं की थी इन्होंने प्रोसेस फॉलो नहीं किए थे इसीलिए इनको निकाला जा रहा है तो आज तक वो सवाल उठाए नहीं गए और जिन्होंने सवाल उठाए उनको एंटी नेशनल करार दे दिया गया है तो ये एक बड़ी डेलिबरेट स्ट्रैटेजी थी जिसमें ऑपोजिशन कुछ ज़्यादा कर नहीं पाई और वो एक तरह से वो एक ट्रैप में गिर भी गई थी वो तो जब जब कोई ऑपोजिशन का लीडर सवाल उठाता तो सारा मीडिया उसको घेर लेता सोशल मीडिया उसको घेर लेता और उसको एंटी नेशनल करार दिया गया होता ये हमने थ्रू आउट इलेक्शन देखा ये सिर्फ तभी की बात नहीं है जब इलेक्शन कैंपेनिंग में भी आपने देखा होगा कुछ कुछ कांग्रेस के नेताओं ने कुछ कुछ अन्य नेताओं ने जब सवाल उठाए थे बालाकोट पर जब सवाल उठाए थे इंटेलिजेंस फेलियर पर तब तक प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी और सारे BJP के अन्य नेताओं ने उनको घेर लिया इलेक्शन रैलीज में उनका बहुत ज़्यादा प्रयोग हुआ और कहीं ना कहीं लोगों को ऐसा भी लगता है कि उस वजह से कांग्रेस को इलेक्शन भी गंवाना पड़ा था तो ये अब देख रहे हैं कि सोशल मीडिया पे जो नैरेटिव सेट होता है ये बड़ी केयरफुली सेट होता है और उसका असर भी दिख रहा है आपको और उसका कैलिब्रेशन पॉलिटिकल कैंपेनिंग में ओपनली भी होता है तो व्हाट्सएप कैंपेन के बहुत बहुत डिफरेंट बहुत अलग अलग पहलू हैं जिसको नज़दीकी से देखने की ज़रूरत है।
तो आपने आपका जो इन्वेस्टिगेशन थे, आपके जो मतलब तहकीकात थी, तो व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप का जो पूरा प्रयोग रहा है ये इलेक्शन 2019 के इलेक्शन के दरमियान, वो आपको और हमको क्या सिखाता है?
वो ये सिखाता है एक तो कि इसमें जैसे मैंने कहा, एक तो आपका पॉलिटिकल कैंपेनिंग जो पहले होती थी कि पॉलिटिकल कैंपेनिंग इलेक्शन के कुछ महीने पहले से शुरू हो जाए, एक बजट पहले से शुरू हो जाए, वो ज़माना अब चला गया है। अब पॉलिटिकल कैंपेनिंग 2400 घंटे
पाँच साल
365 डेज चालू ही है, मतलब 77 शुरू ही है, वो कभी रुकती नहीं है पॉलिटिकल कैंपेनिंग। तो आज अगर हमारे प्रधानमंत्री ने कहीं कुछ कह दिया है तो इमिजिएटली उसका ट्रांसलेशन व्हाट्सएप पे आ जाता है, उसको एक अलग से रूप दे दिया जाता है और वो तुरंत आपके फ़ोन तक पहुँच जाता है। और सिमिलरली जब अगर ऑपोजिशन कुछ गलत कहती है, ऑपोजिशन ने कोई कॉन्ट्रोवर्शियल बयान दिया हो या कभी कभी नहीं भी दिया हो, तो उसको भी आप तोड़ मरोड़ के आप व्हाट्सएप पे लेके आते हो। तो ये कैंपेनिंग कॉन्स्टेंटली चालू है और ये मुझे लगता है हमारी ऑपोजिशन पार्टीज ये सीखी नहीं है कि अब कैंपेनिंग आपको न्याय 3 महीने या 2 महीने पहले अनाउंस करने से नहीं होता, अब आपकी कैंपेनिंग 5 साल चलनी चाहिए, 77 चलनी चाहिए, वो कंटिन्यूस प्रोसेस होना चाहिए। ये तो एक तो ये है कि अब वो कैंपेनिंग का पूरा रूप और नज़रिया बदल गया है। दूसरा है कि कैंपेनिंग के 2 पहलू हैं, एक तो जो प्रो इनकम्बेंट पहलू है वो ये है कि ये जो मैंने मिथ मेकिंग की बात की है कि एक इमेज आप बढ़ाइए, आप कॉन्स्टेंटली वो इमेज को फीड करते रहिए, आप तो वो आज जो वो पढ़ रहा है उसको लगेगा हाँ मैंने 5 साल में यही तो देखा है, मैंने यही देखा है कि मोदी जी इतने अच्छे हैं, मोदी जी इतने स्मार्ट हैं, मोदी जी का सीना 50 इंच का है, सलमान का 40 इंच का है, ये सारा मैंने देखा है, तो अब तो मैं मान ही जाऊँगा 5 साल के बाद जब वो मेरा वोट लेने आएंगे तब मैं मान जाऊँगी मोदी जी ने बहुत अच्छा काम किया है, भले ही ऑपोजिशन सवाल उठाए। तो वो एक मिथ मेकिंग का एक प्रोसेस होता है, एक गवर्नेंस को बढ़ाने का प्रोसेस होता है। और दूसरा प्रोसेस है कि आप ऑपोजिशन को डीलेजिटिमाइज करिए, तो वो भी एक कांस्टेंट प्रोसेस है, वो ऐसा नहीं है कि सिर्फ इलेक्शन कैंपेनिंग में होता है वो। तो अगर आज इलेक्शन कैंपेन में प्रधानमंत्री राजीव गांधी को अगर वो गाली देते हैं या क्रिटिसाइज़ करते हैं, वो आपको ये नज़रिए से देखना चाहिए कि वो एक 5 साल का प्रोजेक्ट है जिसका एक कल्मिनेशन हो रहा है, वो एक वन ऑफ इवेंट नहीं है। तो अगर आप व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप्स पे हो, जो ग्रुप्स पे वो कंटेंट चल रहा है, तो आपको तो लगेगा ये कॉन्फर्मेशन है, मैंने जो इतने साल व्हाट्सएप पे पढ़ा है उसका कॉन्फर्मेशन हमारे प्रधानमंत्री दे रहे हैं कि भाई ये नेहरू गांधी परिवार ने तो ऐसा ही किया था, इन्होंने तो यही फ़ायदा उठाया था, इन्होंने देश को लूटा था, मतलब ये जनरली ये स्टैंड होती है। तो ये आपको अब ऑपोजिशन को ये भी सीखने की ज़रूरत है कि ये कंटिन्यूसली डीलेजिटिमाइज हो रहे हैं और वहाँ कंटिन्यूसली मिथ मेकिंग हो रही है। तो ये 24/7 प्रोसेस 365 डेज फॉर 5 ईयर्स चलने वाला है, तो आप गायब नहीं हो सकते अब इसमें से।
आगे ये कैसे चलेगा? 5 साल तो चल गया, अगले 5 साल उनको मिल गए, उनके पास साधन उनके हाथ में है, सोशल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म्स चाहे वो व्हाट्सएप हो या फेसबुक हो या ट्विटर हो, उनको डेटा भी दे रहा है, मतलब जो डेटा नहीं देना भी चाहिए वो सरकार उनसे ले रही है, और सरकार और पार्टी अभी एक ही हो गई है एक तरफ से आप देखिए। तो ये व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप्स का एक्सटेंट क्या है और इसका सामना कैसे हो सकता है?
देखिए, इसका एक्सटेंट जैसे जब तक मेरी नॉलेज है तब तक ये है कि इसका एक्सटेंट बहुत गहरा है, बहुत डीप रूटेड है ये और बहुत वाइड स्प्रेड है। इसका मतलब ये है कि ये देश के चारों कोनों में फैल गया है। मैं झारखंड में गांव-गांव में गया था, काफ़ी सारे रिमोट गांव में गया था, वहाँ पे भी लोगों को व्हाट्सएप के बारे में पता था, भले ही उनका रिलायंस कम हो उस पर, लेकिन उनको पता था, उनका डिपेंडेंस नहीं था इतना ज़्यादा, लेकिन उनको पता था व्हाट्सएप पे है, उनको पता था कुछ कुछ कॉन्टेंट भी आता है उनके साथ। इसका अब प्रयोग ऐसा होगा कि ऑपोजिशन को तो टारगेट करना है, वो तो बात ठीक ही है, मिथ मेकिंग भी करना है, लेकिन अब जब ये दोनों नहीं हो रहा तो आप क्या करो व्हाट्सएप पे, तो आप कैसे वो व्हाट्सएप के ग्रुप्स एक्टिव कैसे रखो? तो उसका एक उदाहरण मैं देना चाहूँगा। अब पिछले कुछ दिनों में हमने देखा है कि कथुआ रेप का वर्डिक्ट आया, कुछ अन्य केसेस हुए जहाँ के रेप, अलीगढ़ का रेप हो या कोई और हो, मेरठ का हो, तो इनमें से कुछ कुछ रेप्स में अक्यूज जो है वो मुस्लिम समाज के हैं। तो अब व्हाट्सएप पे आजकल कंटेंट ऐसा चल रहा है कि ये मुस्लिम समाज जो डरा हुआ था वो अब एंटी हिंदू हो गया और एंटी इंडिया हो गया क्योंकि मोदी जी जीत गए हैं, है ना। तो अब वो मैसेजेस और अब वो वीडियोस और अब वो सारा जो शेयर हो रहा है वो ये है। तो मेरा ये उदाहरण देने का मतलब ये है कि अब व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप्स आर बेसिकली एक बड़ा सा पॉट है, उसको जलाने के लिए आप कॉन्टेंट देते हो, जैसे आप उसको जलाने के लिए लकड़ी देते हो, ऐसे वो ये कॉन्टेंट देते जा रहे हैं। तो अब आप जो देखेंगे मैसेजेस आ रहे हैं वो एक तरह से वो जो बायस और हेट है उसको जलाने के लिए, उसको फ्यूल करने के लिए ये मैसेजेस स्प्रेड हो रहे हैं। तो व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप्स जैसे एनविसाज होते हैं वो ऐसे ही होते हैं कि जब तक आपको आउट एंड आउट पॉलिटिकल कैंपेन करना हो तो आप कीजिए, लेकिन आप तब तक ये सारे अलग अलग विषयों पे भी आप कॉन्स्टेंटली
जो आपकी बुनियाद है कि आपको एंटी मुस्लिम नफरत फैलाना, एंटी माइनॉरिटी, वो तो आपको चालू ही रखना है 24 घंटा, ताकि आपके सर के दिमाग के पीछे वो बात रहे, जब भी उसको निकालना पड़े आप निकाल।
देखिए व्हाट्सएप का एक प्रयोग ऐसा है और वो बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग प्रयोग है, वो ये है कि पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज जो खुलेआम बात नहीं कर सकती वो व्हाट्सएप पे कर लेती है। वो तो जो नैरेटिव आप अपने इलेक्शन रैलीज में नहीं कह सकते क्योंकि आपको क्रिटिसाइज़ करेंगे लोग, आपको देश अन्य देश के लोग, आपको लीडर्स जो देखेंगे वो एक अलग नज़रिए से देखेंगे, तो आप विकास की बात कर लीजिए रैली में, लेकिन आपके जो व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप्स हैं वो तो मुस्लिम हेट की बात करेंगे या फिर हेट क्राइम की बात करेंगे या कुछ और बात करेंगे आप। तो ये जो ड्यूप्लिसिटी है वो व्हाट्सएप एनेबल करती है, वो अन्य सोशल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म्स भी एनेबल करते हैं। तो ये बहुत एक इंटरेस्टिंग पहलू आ गया है आज इलेक्शन कैंपेनिंग इंडिया में कि आप एक नैरेटिव पे बात कीजिए पब्लिकली, लेकिन यू नो प्राइवेटली व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप्स पे, सोशल मीडिया पे आप एक अलग नैरेटिव चला सकते हैं, और वो नैरेटिव बार बार बदल भी सकता है। वो नैरेटिव एक ही रहना चाहिए, वो ज़रूरी नहीं है। तो आज अगर वो नैरेटिव रेप्स के बारे में है, मुस्लिम हेट के बारे में है, कल कुछ और हो जाएगा, लेकिन वो ब्रॉडली वही एजेंडा रहेगा आपका कि आपकी बुनियादी इशूज़ ये हैं और इसी बुनियादी इशूज़ को आप फीड करते रहिए लोगों में।
दक्षिण भारत में तो ये नहीं चला, दक्षिण भारत में ऑपोजिशन पार्टी जीती है और दक्षिण भारत में एक इस तरह का वहाँ पे भी टेक्नोलॉजी बहुत, अगर भी भारतीय जनता पार्टी की वेबसाइट जिस दिन स्वेयरिंग इन हो रहा था वो ऑफिशियली हैक भी हुई, और मगर दक्षिण भारत में इस तरह के व्हाट्सएप क्यों नहीं चले?
देखिए जहाँ तक मेरा इन्वेस्टिगेशन है, मैं अनफॉर्चुनेटली वहाँ नहीं जा पाया हूँ मैं, लेकिन मेरे जो इनसाइट्स मैंने लिए हैं लोगों से बात करते हुए, उसमें ऐसा है कि एक काउंटर अटैक वहाँ से हो रहा है। तो एक काउंटर जो फोर्स आता है जो ये प्रोपेगेंडा या फिर ये कंटेंट को स्टॉप करके अपना अलग कंटेंट चलाए, तो जैसे आपने देखा होगा ट्विटर पे काफ़ी समय जब प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जाते हैं तमिलनाडु, तब तक वो हैशटैग वायरल होता है कि गो बैक मोदी, वो बार बार होते जाता है। और वो ऐसा नहीं कि वो कांग्रेस करा रहा है, कांग्रेस का तो प्रेजेंस ना के बराबर है वहाँ, तो कौन करा रहा है वो? तो इसका मतलब है कि वहाँ पे काफ़ी सारे ऐसे फोर्सेस हैं, अब भगवान जाने वो कौन से फोर्सेस हैं, लेकिन वो फोर्सेस हैं जो डिजिटल प्लेटफॉर्म्स पे, जो सोशल मीडिया पे बीजेपी को की जो मशीनरी है उसको एक जवाब दे सकते हैं, उसको एक अपोज करके उसको बता सकते हैं कि भाई हमारे पास भी ये स्ट्रेंथ है और ये मैन पावर है। तो शायद ये मेरा अंदाज़ है, मैंने ये स्टडी साउथ में नहीं की है, लेकिन ये मेरा अंदाज़ ऐसा है कि शायद डिजिटली सैवी लोग वहाँ ज़्यादा है और काउंट यहाँ वहाँ जो डिजिटल एक्टिविज़म है वो काफ़ी स्ट्रॉन्ग है, शायद इस वजह से वो लोग इतने सक्सेसफुल नहीं हो पा रहे।
और इस तरह की हेगेमनी भी कम है ना, अपर कास्ट अपर क्लास हेगेमनी, वहाँ पे एक द्रविडियन पॉलिटिक्स का इतिहास रहा है। और द्रविडियन पॉलिटिक्स का इतिहास, चाहे वो आप नॉन वेजिटेरियन वेजिटेरियन की डिबेट ले रहे हो या हिंदी हेगेमनी की बात ले रहे हो, उससे बहुत अलग है, कल्चरली बहुत अलग है। हो सकता है वो वजह से वहाँ पे इस तरह के हेगेमनी नहीं चल सकती
बिल्कुल
आराम से।
और दूसरी बात ऐसी है कि आपने वेस्ट बंगाल में देखा होगा एक ग्रीनफील्ड स्टेट बीजेपी के लिए था, मतलब उनकी प्रेजेंस ज़्यादा नहीं थी, उनका कोई बड़ा नेता आज भी नहीं है, वहाँ पे भी अगर वो इतनी शानदार परफॉर्मेंस अगर उन्होंने दी है इलेक्शन में, और उसमें सोशल मीडिया का बहुत बड़ा रोल रहा है, काफ़ी सारी केस स्टडीज़ आई हैं, काफ़ी रिपोर्टिंग हुई है, उसका मतलब है कि वो कहीं ना कहीं वो कोई एक एजेंडा उन्होंने पकड़ लिया है जो जो वोटर के नब्स पे पहुँचा है, वो उनकी पल्स क्या है और क्या है वो एक इलेक्शन इशू बना सके उनको। तो रामनवमी की रैलीज हो या फिर हनुमान जयंती की रैली हो या फिर वो कम्युनलाइजेशन हो या फिर ममता बनर्जी को एंटी हिंदू कहना, ये सारी अलग अलग स्ट्रैंड्स हैं जो उन्होंने प्रयोग की है और जो कहीं ना कहीं स्ट्राइक हुई है ऑडियंस और जो वोटर्स के मन में। तो वो मुझे लगता है वो प्रयास अब चल रहा है साउथ में भी, केरला में आपने देखा शबरीमला में काफ़ी सारा हुआ, तो उन्होंने अटेम्प्ट तो काफ़ी की थी, लेकिन वो शायद अब तक कमज़ोर पड़ा है, शायद अब तक वो फोकस नहीं कर पाए हैं उतना। लेकिन मुझे लगता है अगर यही मशीनरी बनी रही और अगर काउंटर अटैक या फिर काउंटर फोर्स नहीं आता है तो फिर शायद वो वहाँ पे भी सक्सेसफुल हो जाएंगे, वो इट्स अ मैटर ऑफ टाइम।
बंगाल की आपने बात कही तो वो डेफिनेटली आपने जो बात कही कि वो सिटीजनशिप बिल, NRC का मुद्दा, कम्युनलाइजेशन, रामनवमी, मगर साथ साथ बंगाल में आप याद रखिए कि वहाँ पे फोर कॉर्नर कॉन्टेस्ट भी था।
एब्सोल्युटली,
क्योंकि एक बात जब हम टेक्नोलॉजी के ऊपर हमको जरूर नजर रखनी चाहिए, और व्हाट्सएप वहाँ पे कलकत्ता में एक बैठे हुए उज्जवल प्रतीक नाम के एक नौजवान है, अमित शाह ने उनको पिकअप करके 7,000 की तनख्वाह देकर उन्होंने 50,000 व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप बनाए हैं जिसमें ये जहर उगाला जा रहा है। तो स्प्लिंटर ऑपोजिशन का भी मुद्दा है, क्योंकि कभी कभी हमको लगता है कि हम बाइनरी में देखने लगते हैं मामला, तो फिर अलग अलग चीज को भूल जाते हैं.
बिल्कुल.
तो वहां पे एक स्प्लिंटर ऑपोजिशन भी था, क्योंकि अगर साथ में आप देखें टीएमसी, कांग्रेस और लेफ्ट, इट वाज अ फोर कॉर्नर कॉन्टेस्ट दैट मेड द बीजेपी स्टार्स इजीयर.
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, एब्सोल्युटली. एंड आई फील लाइक व्हाट्सएप इज समथिंग दैट बेसिकली फीड्स इनटू अ लॉट ऑफ एग्जिस्टिंग मैक्रो थीम्स. आप व्हाट्सएप को आइसोलेशन में नहीं देख सकते, और मैं ये आई डोंट बिलीव दैट व्हाट्सएप हैज स्वंग द इलेक्शन फॉर द बीजेपी कंप्लीटली. व्हाट्सएप इज एन इंटीग्रल पार्ट ऑफ द लार्जर कैंपेन. इट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ द स्ट्रेटजी. बट आई थिंक टू से दैट सोशल मीडिया इटसेल्फ हैज वन द इलेक्शन इज फॉल्स. What social media does do and what WhatsApp does do is it confirms biases or it confirms perceptions, you know,
and very effectively communicates.
Very effectively. So it's coming to your phone. There is no intermediary. There is no one to stop it. You know, when you watch the news,
there's no contestation.
And if I'm a friend of Teesta, and if I send her a message, she's going to have that trust on me that I am sending her the message, you know.
Yeah.
So there's an implicit trust in the way WhatsApp also functions, which is not as much in Facebook or not as much in Twitter or Instagram or wherever else, right? Because you have a much larger pool of people who are on your feed. There are 500, 300, 400 people. But WhatsApp is an intimate space in that sense. So I don't think that WhatsApp or any other platform can swing the election completely. But what it can do is that it can solidify certain perceptions that, you know, a political campaign would want, you know, the perception to take place firstly.
Yeah, yeah.
So in UP, for instance, I saw how there was constantly, you know, there were some reports as well, but on the ground, a lot of people would keep telling me that, you know, Mayawati will walk out and Mayawati will join the BJP once the elections are over. And I said, how do you know this? And they said, oh, it's on WhatsApp, you know, it's all here. You know, we've got messages saying that it's a matter of time. Mayawati is doing this only to gain seats. Now, this is a perception that was there somewhere, right? Because these are SP, BSP are unnatural allies. You know, they've been fighting for so many years. Will they stick? And what WhatsApp did was in some ways solidify that perception and said, okay, they're not going to stick. You know, she's going to walk out. So yeah, WhatsApp does solidify perceptions the same way it solidifies biases as well.
Yeah.
So if you are somewhere a person who, you know, who has communal hatred deep down in their mind, WhatsApp is feeding into it. You know, WhatsApp is fueling it in that sense. It's nourishing it, and it's making it grow larger and larger.
There are two things which you've mentioned three things rather.
Right.
Which I'd like to talk to you about separately. One is that ये जो नफरत भरे जो गुनाह हैं, हेट क्राइम्स, हेट क्राइम्स और व्हाट्सएप का क्या रिश्ता है? व्हाट इज द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन द इफेक्टिवनेस ऑफ व्हाट्सएप एंड द हेट क्राइम्स दैट यू हैव कवर्ड सीन, पर्टिकुलरली आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट झारखंड व्हिच हैज बिकम अ सीट ऑफ अ लॉट ऑफ सच क्राइम्स इन द लास्ट 5 years एंड वी डोंट सी एनी ऑफ दैट लेटिंग अप एट द मोमेंट.
तो इन टर्म्स ऑफ झारखंड
एंड द सेकंड वाज रामनवमी एंड द पॉप कल्चर.
राइट. So to answer that first question of yours, what I saw with Jharkhand and WhatsApp was very interesting, where WhatsApp was being used in the spots where hate crimes had happened or in the spots where there is a lot more of communal polarization. What I saw was that WhatsApp was used in primarily two ways. You know, one was to fuel a hate crime. So it was
like we saw in Rajasthan also with Raj Samand.
Absolutely.
Rakhbar,
yeah. You know, so it was fueling and it was bringing things to a point where a hate crime would happen.
Yeah.
The other was to then use a hate crime to spread hate and to disseminate a lot of this hate-filled content. And I'll give you two examples. There is a village in Koderma district in Jharkhand where there were animal remains found in a village.
Yeah.
Right. Now, animal remains were found and no one knew who had obviously stored them. But someone basically said that, listen, that Muslim man there, he had a feast for his son's wedding. You know, so it must be him.
Yeah.
It must be him feeding his guests beef. And someone spread that on WhatsApp. So someone took a photo of those animal remains and wrote a caption saying, Juman Mia is his name. Juman Mia had fed his guests beef and hence, you know, and we found the remains of the animals. Within minutes, there were thousands of people outside Juman Mia's house. And they went on to attack him. You know, they assaulted him. He's a 60-year-old guy. They went on to attack him. They assaulted him. They called him a Jola, which is, you know, a derogatory term for Muslims. So clearly there was a religious hate which was playing a part here. And then they went on to attack the local mosque as well, you know, which doesn't really have any connections with the crime itself. So you see, this is one way of WhatsApp and hate messages on social media leading to a crime.
Mm.
The other is I saw repeatedly across different hate crime spots, was that once a hate crime was committed, the perpetrators of the crime would have WhatsApp videos. So if they were lynching someone, they would make WhatsApp videos of the lynching and then they would spread it because they want to send out a message.
That we can do it.
That we can do it and that no one else should dare to do this, you know. Mm. So in places where they suspected that the victim was carrying beef, for instance, or was a cattle trader, I'm sorry. They would try and, you know, they would lynch that person and they would record videos, you know, they would record the whole thing and say, if you trade in cattle and henceforth, or if you consume beef henceforth, this is what is going to happen. And I've seen this repeatedly in different cases. So it's being used in two different ways in a place like Jharkhand.
And of course, there's silence from the top, whether it's the BJP central leadership, whether it's the prime minister, whether it's the chief minister of Jharkhand, Raghubir Das. There was never a comment condemning any of these attacks.
No, not at all.
So I think that the media is not asking. No?
So,
whether it's mainstream media or television, nobody's calibrating and asking why. I remember we asked Rajiv Gandhi the question. You were probably not even born then. I'm talking about when the Sati incident took place in Devrala. Dilip Pargaonkar, we were sitting at a journalist table and we asked Times of India. Dilip Pargaonkar was then the editor. There was a meeting of the Women's Feature Service and we asked him why Times of India had not carried editorial comment on the Sati incident for 22 days after the incident.
Hmm.
And as media persons, we asked.
Right.
And the answer that Dilip gave us was that Times of India wrote an editorial comment after Rajiv Gandhi spoke, which is means he spoke 21 days after. But there was somebody asking that question.
Absolutely.
Today, whether Modi condemns an incident or not, Amit Shah, now Home Minister, may not condemn any such incident or not.
Right.
Aligarh has been burning for the last four days. No question to Aditya Nath, no question to Amit Shah.
Right.
So they have actually been elevated to the level of monarchs who can't be asked questions.
Right. And it's interesting in this particular context, in Jharkhand, I mean, asking questions is wishful thinking in such circumstances. In Jharkhand, the two instances that I mentioned to you, there was one instance of two cattle traders, Muslim cattle traders, who were lynched, the videos were recorded, they were circulated, all of that. And I went and met the family, I went and met the accused. The local BJP MP, who's now gotten re-elected, MP from Godda, Nishikant Dubey, He, as soon as the lynching happened, as soon as the cops arrested the accused, you know, which is also something that doesn't happen very soon, the cops had arrested the accused. The first thing that he did was he went to the village of the accused and he stationed himself
there. We had Jayant Sinha doing that.
No, yeah. So then the second
Union minister doing that.
Absolutely. So Nishikant Dubey sponsored the accused, their legal aid. You know, I mean, these are people who the cops have held to be accused.
That's what Jayant Sinha, Union minister.
Yeah, and Jayant Sinha later and very recently in a BBC interview, he said that he did not just garland the victims of, and not just, sorry, not the victims, the
accused.
People who were not even accused, but they were convicted of the crime, you know. So they were not even talking of accused persons who were in a cloud of doubt, you know. We're talking of people who've been convicted of lynching. He not just garlanded them, but he was sponsoring their legal aid. He said this to BBC.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're seeing that. So I think our expectation from the state has to
be. We saw that in Gujarat in 2002.
Yes.
It's not the first time. We saw that state actually funding, the state that ran the RSS and the VHP, saying that we'll fund all the accused, whether it's Bajrangi, Kodnani, all their cases.
Absolutely.
And they said it openly. And I think it's that Gujarat model that you're now seeing all over India.
Yeah. And I mean, I feel like people like these, you know, who are coming out and saying this with impunity need to be questioned much more. You know, so the state recedes into the background and there are these people who come out and say these things. So the family of
No, and the role of the media in elevating the state above questioning.
Absolutely.
The media, whether it is television, whether it is your famous anchors who are more progressive than others, they are not walking into the Home Minister's office or the Prime Minister's office and asking them, why are you not commenting?
Mm, far from it.
So they are in fact sitting in their television studios and holding discussion, but not raising the question as to why the executive is not condemning such acts.
Absolutely. And I mean, and I saw this across my travel in UP and in Jharkhand, that people are now questioning the television media a lot. So a lot of people have stopped.
They are.
A lot of people have stopped watching television or they watch it with a very critical lens, you know, because they think, oh, television doesn't have any integrity left, you know. So, and this again gets divided along political lines. So people who are critics of Modi and the BJP will say that these are all paid, you know, by the BJP and Modi. Whereas the supporters of BJP and Modi supporters, they basically think that TV is not doing anything. They're not showing the truth. You know, the truth is that the world is great and the country is greater.
Yeah.
So it's interesting, but the TV media has lost that sense of credibility. And I found that across my channels, you know, so the fact that, you know, the TV media is not asking these questions, the fact that they're not doing journalism the way it's supposed to be done is somewhere registering with people. Unfortunately, what has happened is that this loss of credibility has meant that the dependence of the audience on WhatsApp, you know, on WhatsApp has increased.
Yeah.
Because WhatsApp is now being recalibrated as a tool where you can access news. And that's the interesting part about, you know, the content and the propaganda that's on WhatsApp.
That's part of your thesis which you're trying to develop. My next question is going to be that the contrasting WhatsApp with print media and the news.
So one thing that I did realize in my investigation was that a lot of the WhatsApp content was designed to look like news. It's you know, it will have headlines, it will have figures, you know, it will have all of that.
To give it a stamp of legitimacy.
To try and legitimize this, saying this is not the BJP saying this, or this is not the Congress saying it. This is some independent third agency which is certifying that, you know, that Mr. Modi is the greatest in the world, for instance, right? And you see, that's a very careful calibration. So WhatsApp as a messaging app has been now reoriented to become a platform for news. And what is happening is this happens at the same time when the mainstream media's legitimacy is anyway going down. You know, so it's going down when the Prime Minister doesn't grant interviews, or it goes down when the Prime Minister doesn't have a press conference.
Except on the 19th of May.
Which I don't think should be ideally called a press conference. It's a press briefing, and we should call it that. But I feel like these two processes are happening simultaneously. You know, so you can't look at WhatsApp in isolation as well. You look at it as a process where you're creating an alternative source of news and information, I would say, and you're also delegitimizing the mainstream media. So where do people go for news? You know, they go to WhatsApp, and WhatsApp has been owned by a political strategy and a political ideology, you know, which is only going to give you news that it wants to. And it's, they're not even news, honestly, most times.
Now, the other two issues which you've raised obliquely and which you're going to be working on, I think, more now. One is that, let's look at the Ram Navami celebrations.
Right.
And I'm particularly interested in looking at these three states, which is Bihar, Jharkhand and Bengal.
Right.
Because we've done some stories in Sabrang, etc. And we find that the way this Ram Navami festival, the processions, of course, Durga Puja also, but are being used deliberately with a very aggressive and hegemonic intent.
Right.
Which is also culturally altering the face of the states that they are in terms of the local culture.
Absolutely.
But it's also feeding into this WhatsApp culture and the overall Hindutva project.
Right.
So, I mean, what would you...
Absolutely. I mean, what I did notice in Jharkhand especially is that in Ram Navami has always been a very big festival, you know, for Jharkhand. And
it's has not been in Bengal.
Which has not been the case in Bengal. So there's that model being replicated in Bengal. But in Jharkhand, to be fair, it's always been a big festival. It's always had its share of communal polarization that goes along with it.
Okay.
What has now happened increasingly is that it's been very, very carefully calibrated and very carefully executed. And there's very interesting, you know, exchanges in this whole project. So, in a lot of cases, I found, at least in two cases, I found that the people who were running these Ram Navami processions, which were, you know, again, communally dangerous and resulting in riots, were the people who were accused in lynching someone. So we found that in Ramgarh, for instance.
So it's like society actually legitimizing these criminals.
Absolutely. So,
and through religion.
Yeah. So in Ramgarh, for instance, Ramgarh's Ram Navami has been extremely problematic in many ways because it does trigger off some sort of communal violence or some sort of hate against communities. What we do see is that these two people who were, you know, in charge of the processions and who were big people in the procession in that world, would routinely talk to the cops, and the cops would ask them for CDs, for instance. And that's one thing that they do, is that they play music which is provocative, you know. So they play music which is hate-filled.
You had quoted two lines.
Yes. So it basically, there's a line which says, Har ghar bhagwa chayega, Ram Raj bhi aayega. And, you know, it then goes on to say that, Gau hatya ko band karenge, ye sankalp hamara hai. And these are all, you know, and then it goes on to also talk of how it's going to be a Hindu Rashtra, how the people who live in India will have to say Vande Mataram, you know. And these are all lines which are not ordinarily associated with Hinduism.
Yeah.
These are all lines associated with Hindutva.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, they're very political. They're often used as rhetoric by the BJP and its affiliated organizations. So you see, this is making an entry into Ram Navami. And what often happens is, you know, when the Ram Navami procession traditionally, it basically, you know, what has happens through the district or through the town. and it goes through different areas, including Muslim areas.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, typically what would happen is Muslims would come out of homes, they would give the processionists water, mm-hmm. some sweets maybe, all of that. But now what often happens is that these processions stop outside Muslim areas or often stop outside mosques. And then they play songs like this, you know.
Which are determined to provoke.
Determined to provoke, you know. And I found instances where this was happening and then the cops had to step in and stop it. In Gumla, for instance, you know, the Ram Navami procession of that day did exactly this. You know, they stopped outside the local mosque and they played a song whose lines I don't quite remember, but it said something to the effect of "Mulle ki topi gira denge," you know,
very derogatory
towards Muslims, and you're right outside a mosque, you know. So I spoke to some people who were a part of the Muslim delegation who were waiting outside to welcome these people. You know, and suddenly they see that the music is completely different, you know, and it's very strategically changed when they reach the mosque. So these people suddenly swung into action because they had to stop the Muslim community from getting provoked, you know, and to react. So the cops thankfully were there. This was stopped right then. This was nipped in the bud. But what happened, and it's interesting to draw these parallels and join the dots, is that in the same evening, a couple of hours later, when some of these processionists were going home, they ended up lynching a Muslim boy who was 20 years old because he was seen with a Hindu girl. So, you know, they basically said that this is love jihad. They tied him to a pole and they lynched him right there. So you see these interesting parallels that hate is getting mainstreamed through these different mediums. It's not only one thing. It's coming to you from very, very different, in very different ways as well. Be it music, be it WhatsApp.
The pop culture.
Yeah. This is an all-encompassing pop culture. This is an alternative media space, which is something that a lot of people in the cities don't have the access to. We don't know it exists. But I think it's interesting to gain an understanding and gain an entry into this world to try and see what is the content that's, you know, constantly being consumed. So if your galaxy or if your universe of pop culture will only promote hate against other communities, is there any chance that you will not be provoked? You know, or is there any chance that you will not then be biased, you know, if that's all you're listening to? And I think a deeper investigation is needed into that world and that universe.
Which I'm sure we'll see from you. But how do you counter this? I mean, how is this sort of phenomenon ever countered?
I think the first step is understanding this. I'm sorry. We need to gain a better understanding of what is happening. And as I see it, the media doesn't do that.
Yeah.
The mainstream media, we've all failed in doing that. We've all failed in understanding what is happening in this country, you know.
And the newspapers are not looking at these investigations, are they?
Unfortunately, I don't see them doing that, you know, except a couple of exceptions. I don't see most of them trying to even enter that ecosystem. And I think that's where it really starts. You know, maybe we should have more investigations. Maybe we should just understand why is it that, you know, that people are getting provoked by music like this, or why does that music exist? Because as I see it, hate is great commerce. You know, hate, nothing sells like hate. You know,
it always has been. Look at Nazi Germany. Look at the neo-Nazis.
Absolutely, you know, and capitalism does work its way in ensuring that, you know, you do co-opt hate and you make it your own. So if you see the top two English channels in our country right now, they are very routinely spewing hate and vitriol against
communities. Which ones do you call the top two? I'm curious.
The top two, according to ratings, unfortunately, not to my liking, are Times Now and Republic TV.
Mm.
And you often see this, you know, you often see them asking very provocative questions. And that for me is unfortunate. But, you know, it sells. The fact that they're number two and number one in the ratings chart shows that hate is selling. And in the same way, we also have to understand this industry that's taking shape around hate, but not in the big cities, you know, in smaller towns in India, in villages in India. So some of the songs that I mentioned to you, some of the pop music, these are all songs which have had a million and more, you know, millions and millions of hits on YouTube, for instance. There are pop stars who are dishing out this kind of music. There are pop stars who are celebrities in that world, which is why I feel like I think it's time for us to reflect and understand that world better. As I see it, I don't think there's enough interaction between these parallel universes in India. We're all living in our own little echo chambers, you know, which is why a lot of people in the town, in the cities, for instance, were very shocked with the verdict. You know, they didn't see it coming at all because they are on Twitter. They spend their time on Twitter or they spend their time on Facebook. And that's the only interaction you have with possibly with people who are not your ideology, you know, apart from your friends. And I feel like that gap has to be now bridged. We start with that and then we devise strategies and see how we can counter it.
I don't know if there's anything else which I've not asked which you'd like to say, because it's a very illuminating conversation, I think, even for our viewers.
I hope it is. I mean, nothing much, but apart from the fact that I think it's time that we also reflect on our use of social media platforms and see what we're... So what often I see is that people like you and me would innocently forward messages which are hate-filled or which are completely untrue, you know, because I believe the sender, you know. Yeah. And I feel like it's increasingly important for us to de-link the sender from the message. You know, the messenger and the message are two very different things. WhatsApp, the way it works is that it transfers the implicit trust on the messenger to the message. And I feel like I think it's also time that we start using social media platforms much more carefully now.
Yeah.
And we start calling out hate when we see it.
You just had two recent examples that happened with us. I'd just like to share to end this program.
Right.
Over the weekend, a friend of mine, I don't want to mention names, was very disturbed because he got a WhatsApp forward where there was a kind of a, looked like a front page. Like you said, it looked like a front page of a tabloid.
Right.
A full page of a tabloid, not front page. Where you had, look at these criminals, 20 criminals from one peaceful community. Mm. That had obviously been transposed, that headline. And you saw a name of alleged shoplifters.
Mm.
And they happened to be all from the minority community.
Right.
And the person was very disturbed because it had suddenly started doing the rounds for 24 hours, being put on Facebook and also on WhatsApp groups.
Right.
Also on a Christian group. I mean, so this is the scary
Absolutely.
Part. I Googled the title and I found that it was an article carried by Midday in October.
Right.
And now I've got both the WhatsApp, I've got the Midday article and the WhatsApp forward.
Right.
That's one example. And today on Twitter, I find somebody in Delhi has started saying that Kejriwal has given a lakh of rupees to so-and-so who happens to be a Muslim general or whatever it is, but has not given Ankit Saxena's family.
Right.
And that person is gone and asked Ankit Saxena's family that you've not got any money. Now, none of this is based on fact. If you look at the entire thread, because people have tried to clarify it.
Mm.
But again, you see that factory at work.
Absolutely.
Between WhatsApp and Twitter.
Yeah.
And it looks like many of us will have to spend full time, not just trying to decode those myths, but trying to create an alternate narrative.
Right.
Because I think decoding itself is not enough. Some people are doing it, alt news, etc. But I think decoding itself obviously is not enough.
Right.
You need to be creating an alternate narrative as well. So that
is really
a challenge.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I feel like, I think it's interesting you give those examples, because I often see that happening a lot on these WhatsApp groups that I routinely get access to. Is that there is always an element of truth in
but
the messages.
But that's still the myth and stereotype. I mean,
Absolutely.
Long before WhatsApp, we started at working on myths and stereotypes against minorities.
Right, right. Yeah.
And there'll always be a 10% of a shade of truth.
Absolutely.
Which makes it ring a bell, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that then the 90% will all be kind of amplified falsehood.
And so, which is why, I mean, when people ask me, is WhatsApp to be blamed or is Facebook to be blamed? How do you blame them for the hatred that we've always been carrying, you know?
But you blame them for passing on data.
I blame them for not doing enough to prevent the misuse, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But to say that this is happening only
because you saw our Deepak Sharma video. Right?
Absolutely.
Now
he's
back up.
Yeah, so, I mean, what you're doing is you're legitimizing these people much more Facebook, than WhatsApp.
Yeah.
Because Facebook does offer a platform to them. WhatsApp, it's obviously much more difficult to track these people now. But you're providing that platform, you know, and that's a very, very potent platform to provide to begin with. So I feel like that's where you also blame them. But I think as a society, we must also reflect on our own biases and our stereotypes. And if there is, you know, material that's provocative, why are we getting provoked then?
Yeah.
You know, can't we not have a system in our own selves to say, I'm not going to forward this message, you know, for instance. But that's also failed in some ways.
And finally, let's not forget that 27,000 crores officially is what's spent on an election.
Absolutely.
Unaccounted money. We don't know whose money it is. So none of this, all these 50,000 WhatsApp groups plus would exist, but for the money paid to those people to run them. So
absolutely. Yeah.
I think it's an imbalanced scenario that the Indian election scenario has become, in which there are 6 or 7 aspects to it that we'll have to keep looking at.
Right.
The EVM question, the money powers question, the technology, communication, organization section, the hate mongering,
that's
splintered opposition, all of these will make up probably the decoding of the story.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So we'll continue our conversation. Great. And thanks, Kunal,
thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank you, Zain. Thank you.